Can't do that either, fellers. The men's meeting next week because the carpet's being laid. But you know, we could do it over there. We could do it in the youth area. So, yep, next Monday will be our men's fellowship meeting. So, men, if you can, come out for that. We will feed you. Not sure what exactly, but we will feed you if you can. Just come out for the men's fellowship meeting. Also, this weekend is the teenager and young adult camp out down at Potter's Ranch. Thank you. I'm getting older. So lots of things going on in the church, for sure. So watch it. Watch on Facebook if you can. You'll see a lot of announcements being made. Got a good-looking couple here on the back row. Everybody turn and wave at them. Say hi.
Hi.
You're welcome. Got a mom and her boy here on the second row. Look at them and wave. Say hi.
Hi.
All right. Now that they've been embarrassed, we can have church. Amen. That's what I do. So let's all stand. Let's invite God into our service tonight. And let's jump right into praise and worship. Praise and worship is a whole lot better when everybody gets involved. It sounds a whole lot better when everybody sings.
Amen.
Not whispers the song, but belts out the song. And you're more likely to receive something if you put something in. So everybody, let's practice. Let's wave a hand. Let's raise a hand. It's not bad to do that. We can worship. Turn around and wave at some people. Smile at them. How you doing? What's going on? Good to see you. All right, now that we're all friends, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight, God, thanking you for all of your blessings. God, thank you for a beautiful day. God, thank you for the chance to be with you this morning, God, and to hear from your word and to sing your praises this morning. Father, we pray now that you would just flow mightily in this place tonight. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen. Remain standing if you can.
Amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord tonight, church.
Some glad morning we shall see Jesus in the air. Coming after you will be joys ours to share. What rejoicing there will be when the sun shall rise. Head for that jubilee yonder in the skies. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. See to now I almost see all the saints are dead. Rise before that jubilee that's just ahead. In the twinkling of an eye, change for them to be all the living saints who fly to that jubilee. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. When with all that heavenly host we begin to sing, singing in the Holy Ghost, how the heavens will ring. Millions there will join the song with the beast shall be. Praise and Christ through ages long, heaven's jubilee. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the sky. Let's sing that third verse again. All that heavenly host we begin to sing, singing in the Holy Ghost, how the heavens will ring. Millions there will join the song, with the beast shall be praising Christ through ages long, heaven's jubilee. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior. See that chorus again. And oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes. God like Jehovah, there's no 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 God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet calls. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. And the trumpet call is your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hills sounding. Behold, he comes, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. And the trumpet call is your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hills sounding. Lift your voice, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Can touch my heart like you do. angels cry, holy, holy is the Lord. I see the Lord, and His eyes are flaming like fire. I see the Lord. holy is the Lord.
Amen. Can we give the Lord a praise offering tonight, church? Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated.
From the top of my head to the soul of my feet, I felt the Spirit moving. Thanks, Paul. Good evening. We all agree that wisdom is a good thing. I think it is. But the funny thing is about wisdom, it depends on what kind of wisdom it is you're talking about. See, fleshly wisdom, that kind of tarnishes sometimes and kind of fades away. In other words, you know, what's profound today might be foolishness tomorrow. In the world, that's the way things go a lot of times. Spiritual wisdom, on the other hand, is timeless. It's of God, and it'll stand the test of time. It'll always be true, and it'll always be something you can count on. I want to share something today from Proverbs. Now, Proverbs, mostly anyway, was written by Solomon, who was supposedly the most preeminent wise man of the day. So when you hear this today, kind of think of it as if it's coming not from a couple thousand years back, but if it's coming to you from God now. This is Proverbs chapter 4, verses 20 through 27. It says, "My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. For they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Put away from thee a froward mouth," that's deceitful mouth, "and perverse lips put far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the paths of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil." I think if we were to continue to be in a situation where we understood that wisdom and kept wisdom like that in front of us today, instead of man's wisdom, the world's wisdom, I think we'd be an awful lot better off than what we are. Sometimes the wisdom we follow today, as I said, it's worldly wisdom. It doesn't really profit us. Spiritual wisdom profits always. Amen? It's time for us to take up our tithes and offerings. Can we have the ushers come forward, please? JT, would you pray over the offering tonight, please? Amen.
Hit it in his message this morning. We are talking about overcoming, right? Not just overcoming sin, but overcoming the battles that we deal with on a daily basis. And every one of us has a battle that we deal with every day. And, you know, we all face things. Sometimes the things that we face are our fault. And sometimes we deal with things that we have no control over. But I know the one that does have control over every situation that I face. I may not have the answer. The doctors may not have the answer right. The people may not have the answers, but God does. And so as I do the song, if God has ever done anything for you, if he's ever helped you overcome anything, just worship him because he is worthy of our praise.
Worthy of all our praise.
children's church quietly walk out. Lori, come on up and sing for us, please.
You know, and because he overcame, we can overcome.
Amen.
You know, how sad would it be if everything that he said wasn't true and that he's still lying in a grave somewhere? He didn't overcome then. But we know, we have a good report out of the Word of God that says that on the third day, they went to the tomb expecting to put some spices on his body. That's what Mary Magdalene did. And when she got there, she was just a little distraught because the stone was rolled away. And when she peeked in, she started crying. And the angels answered her and said, because she was crying, where have they taken him? Where have they taken him? He's not here. He's risen. And that same spirit that raised him from the dead is one day going to quicken our mortal bodies, and those that are dead in Christ right now, they are asleep. They're going to rise first. And we which are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up with him. And there shall we ever be with the Lord. That spirit, that third person of the triune Godhead, he's here tonight. You know, we always, you know, and we give worship to the Father. We give worship to the Son. We need to give worship to the Holy Spirit as well, because they three are together working as one. Amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Lift your eyes to heaven, there is freedom. If you'll just lift your eyes, there is freedom, freedom, freedom reigns in this place. Of mercy and the Lord is, there is freedom. Just lift your eyes to heaven. There is freedom. There is freedom. If you'll just lift your eyes to heaven.
Sit and think about what is being sung here and the things that are being done around here. I think sometimes it becomes habit, it becomes ritual, and because it becomes habit and ritual, sometimes I think we miss or we're not hearing what's actually being sung to us or preached to us. We're going to go back to the same scripture as we did this morning, if you don't mind. Does anybody remember that? I know Jessica doesn't. It is Judges 3 and 2. All right, there it is. She got ahead of me. She did. If you sit and think sometimes about the things that we sing, things that are being said around here, there is a lot of power and there's a lot of meaning in what's actually going on. I mean, we say things like freedom. What does freedom actually mean? I mean, we all have a definition of freedom in our minds, but we're not talking about just a physical freedom. We're talking about a mental freedom, and we're talking about a spiritual freedom. We are set free according to what the Word of God says. Normally, we're set free from everything. Amen. How about you guys read this for me? Ready? One, two, three, go. You guys sound awesome. How about we do it one more time? Go ahead. You guys are good. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for allowing us to be in your house one more time tonight, God. Father, I pray now that you would help me to bring forth the message that you've given me, God. Prepare, God, these souls, these minds, God, these spirits, God, to receive your word here now, we pray, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Give God a huge hand clap, and you can be seated. This morning, we were talking about a couple people by the name of Joshua and Moses. And as I pointed out, I believe the scriptures really points out the differences in the style of leadership of Moses and Joshua. As we said this morning, Moses brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, which was a physical bondage. Joshua brought the children of Israel out of the wilderness, which was more of a mental bondage. If we study Joshua and Moses together, we will find that Moses relied a lot on what God performed, the miracles that were performed. And as I said this morning, many Christians today won't move unless God does something for them. Somebody say amen. Many Christians today are waiting on a word. They're waiting on an act. They're waiting on a feeling. And some people might say, well, Pastor, what's wrong with that? If you've been in Christianity long enough, if you've been serving God long enough, you will know that there are dry spells that Christians go through. And those dry spells oftentimes do not give you a goosebump. Sometimes it sounds like heaven is locked up and God is not speaking to us for a long period of time. So what are those times for? Those times are for us growing in faith. Those are the times when you make it up in your mind that you are saved, that you are a child of the Most High God. You believe down deep inside that God has not forgotten you. God has not left you. And whatever it is you're dealing with or going through, God will show up when it's time to show up. Amen. It's through those wilderness or desert type experiences where you and I learn how to depend upon God more and more and more. Joshua, under the leadership of Moses, he had some time to learn how to depend upon God. Joshua, under the leadership of Moses, he was surrounded by a people that did not believe God's word. Somebody say amen. God told them that the land was theirs. It was theirs for the taking. But the people would continually say, no, it's not possible. Look at the giants. Look at the walls. Look at what they've got. So they would stay out. So under the leadership of Moses and being surrounded by his elders during that time, if Joshua really learned from them, he could have learned how to be negative. He could have learned how to say all the wrong things when it was time for a child of God to have faith. Have you ever been around people that when it's time for you to have faith, they say all the wrong things? Amen. Don't you love those people that try to help you along in your walk? Amen. You're trying to trust in the Lord. You're having faith in God. You know that God has told you to do something or to stand still or not to do something. And they're trying to tell you to do something totally contrary to what you're feeling down in your soul. Has anybody got friends like that?
Amen.
Amen. Joshua was feeling down in his soul, we should do this. He was surrounded by people who said, no, we should not do this. Amen. Joshua had a way, he had an experience, he had a knowledge of God. And the way he got this knowledge, the way he gained this experience, this ability to fight a warfare was from what he saw. How many of you have the ability to learn from what you see? Amen. If I'm watching somebody build a building, somebody help me tonight. They're putting a building together, and as soon as the building's done, the building falls down. Did you learn anything? You should have. You should have learned not to build the building the way they're building it. Somebody say amen. You should have learned that that individual has no idea what they're talking about when it comes to putting a building together. Amen. Anybody ever seen that happen? You ask somebody how to fix plumbing. Oh, I know how to fix plumbing. Plumbing's easy. They come over and fix your plumbing and they leave and everything starts to leak. Do they know how to fix plumbing? No. Did you learn anything? Yes. You don't call them anymore. Amen. You call a plumber. Amen. But there are a lot of people out there that will say they know how to do things. There will be a lot of people out there that talk a flashy kind of talk, and they will tell you how to serve God and what to do, when to do it, and how to do it in serving God. So Joshua was truly surrounded by people who talked a pretty decent game. But realistically, if Joshua was learning and paying attention to him, you know what he was seeing? He was watching people that were still doing the circles around in the wilderness. And let me tell you something, saints of God, if you're watching a child of God, a fellow Christian, and all they do is keep walking around in circles and they're not listening to anybody, guess what? You're learning something from them. Amen. You should be learning something from them. You should be learning what not to do. Amen. Because if somebody's continually in trouble, in trials, in strife, in whatever, you know what? If they keep on doing that, something they're doing is wrong. Joshua learned it. Joshua learned that you cannot depend on the words of people all the time. And let me say this as your pastor. Sometimes the words that come out of my mouth may not be the words you need to hear. Come on, I don't care if you amen me on that one. That's okay. Because sometimes people come to the pastor expecting the pastor to have a word. And you know what? He may not have the word. And the reason he may not have the word is because God is saying to you, you should be listening to me at this point. You should be relying on me at this point for me to tell you what to do. Some people might say, Pastor, what do we need you for? Because I look good. Amen. I make anyone know. Because the I don't know. I lost it there. Let's go. What do we need you for, Pastor? To bring the word. But saints of God, listen. There are too many Christians out there today that rely on human beings to bring them the word of God. Amen. You and I, everyone in this room tonight, we need to learn how to get in this and allow God to open up things to us. Amen. Amen. This morning we hit a topic, and it was a good topic, and it goes along with what I've been saying so far. When God says, speak and not hit. Did you hear it? See, Moses was at a place where he was being impacted by the people around him. The people that he had just led out of Egypt were now in a place, Paul, where they had to rely on God. Now, if you know the story properly, God told Moses what he needed to do at the right times. And how many of you know tonight that the word of God tells you and I what we need to do at the right times? So when it came time for Moses to do what God told him to do, he was in a bad spot. Anybody ever been in a bad spot before? You're in a bad spot mentally. You're in a bad spot spiritually. And inside of you, there is a rage going on inside of you. Why? Because you're surrounded by idiots. Pastor, you're not allowed to say idiots. You'll find out here in a minute. But he's surrounded by them, and because he got so influenced and aggravated by those people, instead of speaking to the rock, he smote it. And as we said this morning, we learned in scriptures, because Moses was not obedient to what God told him to do at that point, it hurt him. Amen. Pastor, how did it hurt him? The place where he was supposed to be leading the people to, he himself could not go. And if you read on, those people basically took on Moses-type thinking. When it came time to trust in God, they didn't trust in God. When Moses went up to get them the laws, guess what? They're down there building their own God. Why? Because they didn't want to trust in God. They didn't want to have faith. They didn't want to wait for Moses to come back down and tell them what God had said. Amen. So it got them in a mess. Moses should have known. Listen, saints of God. Moses should have known what power there was in speaking to something. Title of this message this morning was learning how to fight, or learning warfare from God, letting God teach you. Sometimes God teaches you in your mistakes. Sometimes God teaches you that when you are disobedient to him, there are consequences that you have to face. And this is just coming to mind. Sometimes when we're disobedient to God, not following what he told us to do, we often create more giants and more battles for us to face in the future. Amen. As we said this morning, had Eve truly listened to the word of God, she would not have taken part of that fruit, creating a mess of problems for herself. How many of you would be honest tonight and say, because of my not listening to the word, I have created problems for myself? Thank you. Moses should have known. Why? Moses knew the word. He knew what had been written. The stories had been passed down to him. He knew that when God created the earth, God spoke several things into existence. Listen to what I'm saying tonight. God spoke several things into existence. How many of you here tonight know that your words can speak things into existence? We want to talk spiritual things. Listen, let's talk spiritual. Your words can speak things into existence. Somebody say amen. You've heard it said time and time and time again. If you keep telling someone they're stupid long enough, they will eventually come to the place to where they believe they are stupid. Amen. Somebody say amen. But if you tell a child long enough that they are beautiful, that they are a blessing, that they are a treasure, guess what? As time goes on, they will believe that they are beautiful, that they are a blessing, that they are a treasure. Amen. When God spoke things into existence, saints of God, he spoke beautiful things into existence. He spoke things into this world that helped the people that he created. He gave them things through his word, Lori, things that nourished them, things that took care of them, things that would provide for them. But can I say this? When Adam and Eve spoke their doubt into existence, the meaning for all those things that God spoke into existence changed. Why? Because when you start speaking doubt into existence, you don't believe what the word of God says anymore. And can I say this? Many of Christians today are running around doubting what the word of God says. And can I say something? If you're doubting what the word of God says, you are in a mess. We're in existence. We are Christians. We are children of God today because of this book right here. This book right here brought forth, it teaches us, it shows us that there had to be a Savior show up one day. And aren't you glad that he did show up? Amen. And because he showed up, you and I have a salvation. We have an eternal life that's waiting for us. Jesus, when he was walking the earth, he spoke things into existence. But before we get to that, let's back up. God told Moses more than one time to speak something. In Exodus 6 and 11, God is telling Moses, I want you to go in. I want you to speak unto Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, that he let the children of Israel go out of his land. What was the purpose, really? Lana, of God telling Moses, I want you to go in and speak to Pharaoh. Think about that for a minute. Why couldn't God have performed all the miracles that he did without Moses speaking a word? You ever think about that? God told Moses, I want you to go and tell Pharaoh. I want you to go in there and with your own words tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Saints of God, there is meaning in words. Somebody say amen. God knew that when his child went in before Pharaoh, he knew that Pharaoh would deny him. But nonetheless, there would be people in that court standing there watching Moses, the one who was no good in their eyes, come in and say, the God of all glory has said to you to let my people go. In the beginning, it was a joke. Right? Imagine the children of Israel. You know, the rumors had gotten out. They probably heard that there was a man by the name of Moses going into the all-powerful king saying, you should let my people go. And I would venture a guess that the children of Israel were probably snickering at the idea of it too. Somebody say amen. Here is one little bitty man with a stick in his hand going in telling King Pharaoh with all of his armies, let my people go. We talked this morning about the heroin issue going on in northern Kentucky and around the United States. You know what? What would happen if God's children consistently started saying to the enemy and to the drug dealers in this area, let these people go in the name of Jesus. Amen. In the beginning, you would be met with laughter and joking and a mockery. But you know what? If you keep on saying it, if you have enough faith, if you believe in what the Word of God says, your words will turn into reality. So he kept telling him, Moses, I want you to go tell. And in Exodus 6 and 29, that the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, I am the Lord. Speak thou unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, all that I say unto thee. There's a lot of meaning in what God said to Moses there. I am the Lord. I preached forever on those two words, I am. Somebody say amen. There's an awesome message in I am. Amen. But God told him, Moses, when you go into Pharaoh, you tell him, I am told you to let these people go. Amen. Do you believe in the I am? Do we as the church in 2014 believe that the I am still has power over the gods of this world today? Somebody say amen. And you know this story. Moses kept going in unto Pharaoh, and Pharaoh kept getting his heart hardened. Somebody say amen. So you know what? Eventually God started showing Pharaoh. What did Moses do? Moses spoke. Moses listened. Moses followed the rules. And because he spoke what God told him to speak, Dave Turner, guess what? Eventually, Pharaoh let the children of Israel go. So let me ask you something. Those words that Moses spoke to Pharaoh, was there power in them words? Can I say this or ask this? Was there authority in the words that he spoke? Christians in 2014, are there power in the words that you speak today? I believe, Art, that there's a little bit of doubt in us, that there's a little bit of hesitancy and a little bit of fear, that when we speak words of faith, we kind of wonder. I'm supposed to speak peace into my home. I'm supposed to speak love into my home. I'm supposed to speak victory into my wayward child. Is there any power in those words? Moses, when he spoke the words and he followed what God told him to do, there was power in them words. Somebody say amen. Pharaoh finally got to the place to where he linked the power of Moses' words to the things that he was seeing God do. I'm feeling something when I say that. Saints of God, many Christians run around today speaking what God does, but the people around them don't see it happening. Pastor, why is that? Well, sometimes we speak it in doubt. Amen. Anybody ever speak something in doubt? You ever spoke something in boldness and after you say it, you're like, well, I hope that happens. Right? When you speak that God is going to do something, you should speak it with an authority. You should speak it with a faith. And you should speak it knowing that it's going to take place. Somebody say amen. Because if you and I speak according to the word and speak according to God's will, when it is spoken, whatever we bind on earth shall be what? Bound in heaven. Somebody say amen. So you know what, saints of God? What we loose on earth shall also be loosened. Somebody say amen. Saints of God, your words mean something. Amen. Exodus 7 and 2. Thou shalt speak all that I command thee. And Aaron thy brother shall speak unto Pharaoh that he send the children of Israel out of his land. Have you ever been told by God to speak something? Have you ever done it? Have you ever not done it? I took a beating from God one time. Anybody ever take a beating from God? Pastor, does God beat you? Boy, conviction does an awesome job. Somebody say amen. God would say to me, Wayne, I want you to speak to that individual over there. And I don't speak to that individual. And I've had this happen to me before because, I don't know, a fear come over me or something, a doubt or something, and I don't speak it. And then later on, I find out that something bad happened to that individual, and it was my opportunity to speak something to them. Wayne, I want you to get up out of your bed at 3 a.m. and go call this person or drive over and visit this person and speak to them about me, and I don't do it. And the next day I hear something bad happen to the individual. And we could sit and think, well, Wayne, what would your words have done? That's doubt. What we should say is what did we miss out on? Somebody say amen, because the words could have truly done something. Why? Because if our words are backed up by the spirit that's down deep inside of us, when we speak to them, who knows? It could have prevented that individual from experiencing whatever happened to them the next day. Do you believe this tonight? Exodus 19 and 6 says this, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Amen. Why did God tell Moses to speak those words unto the children of Israel? Because it was their future. It was their destination. Somebody say amen. How many of you know that God, when he formed the foundations of the earth, he spoke that you and I would be priests. You and I would be his children. You and I would have authority over the kingdoms of this world. Can I tell you how we lost authority over the kingdoms of this world? Through our words. We do that. So you see, Moses should have known the authority and the power of speaking words. Proverbs 18:21 says this, the tongue can bring death or life. Do you believe it? The tongue can bring death or life. Moses was told to speak to the rock and not hit it. Let me get down to where we live at for a moment. We all deal with situations on a daily basis, don't we? With husbands, with wives, with children. And just like Moses, because sometimes we are surrounded with chaos, craziness, sickness, debt problems, your boss is a jerk, somebody say amen, stuff like that. When you go into a situation dealing with family or something, God says to speak this, but instead, anybody ever been there? When if you'd have spoke a kind word to your husband, you could have diffused the situation, but instead, Lori said right, because she does it all the time. She's mean. Amen. She's mean. We're all guilty of it. I've done it. You ever have that thought stuck in your brain and you know you shouldn't say it and it's right there and you're like, and then eventually out it comes. And once it's out, there is no pulling it back. And you're sitting here thinking, why in the world did I say that? We hit instead of speaking. Sometimes, saints of God, when we hit, it hurts. It hurts the individual that we're speaking to, and it also hurts us. Because you see, sometimes those words that come out of our mouth, like Proverbs says, it brings out death. It'll bring out destruction. And I'm going to tell you something. When it comes to warfare under God's authority and in His presence, guess what, saints of God? Your words do mean something. Your words will bring about a life or a death spiritually. Somebody say amen. Listen, if somebody's coming to you and they're saying, I need help with this, don't you be negative. Somebody say amen. And don't you get down and try to figure it out yourself. It is your job to take them back to the Word of God, lead them in a prayer and let them speak to the Holy One of Israel, amen, so that He can direct them. Amen. You know what you find a lot? In churches, you'll find bickering and fighting and fussing and fuming going on. You know why? Because nobody has said, let's pray about this. Nobody has said, let's go to the individual and work this out. Let's just sit and continue to talk about it. Why? If you continue to talk about it, it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. But if you say to the individual, let's go to God first, you cut it off. You end it right then and there. And if you go to God first, saints of God, if you allow Him to intervene in the situation, something that the enemy meant to be bad. Oh, I'm going to say it again. Something that the enemy meant to be bad. The enemy has a lot of plans for us. He has a lot of tricks for us. He has a lot of snares for us. Maybe he's got a lot of traps for us. And if we're not careful, we'll help his plan come about. We may not physically be involved, but our words, amen, or our lack of action, our lack of proper words will help that come about. Somebody say amen. Do you believe me? You believe what's being said? You know what? Like I say, in these meetings that we're having with Hope Over Heroin, we could all sit there and just whisper and talk about the other church or the other pastor and how they do things. But what good would that do? Somebody say amen. Our words are saying God is in control. God is over this group. God is going to take care of this. God has a plan for this group. And not letting a negative thing come out of our mouth, guess what? There is more likely to be something great take place in Northern Kentucky when everybody is speaking positive. Moses understood it. Moses knew that he should not have hit the rock. Let me say this. Jonah understood what it meant to speak something. Somebody say amen. Does anybody remember Jonah? God told him to do what? Go preach. What is preaching? Talking under an anointing. Somebody say amen. Should be. God said, I want you to go speak to these people. I don't want to go speak to those people because I don't like those people. I don't like those people. Those people should be dead. Somebody say amen. Those people should be wiped off the face of the earth. And because he wouldn't speak the way God told him to speak, because he wouldn't use the words that God gave him, what happened to Jonah? Same thing that happened to Moses. There are consequences for us not doing what God told us to do. When God says to speak a life into somebody, saints of God, and you don't do it, you reap the consequences for it. If God's got a word for you to speak and you don't speak it, somebody help me. Shame on you. If God tells you to speak to somebody and you don't do it, Shame on you. Why? Because the words that you have, the words that God has given you to speak to that individual could set them free. Somebody tell me what happened to Nineveh when Jonah finally got beyond himself. A revival took place in Nineveh, saints of God. Do you understand it? Somebody that had a hatred. Do you understand that? Somebody that had a hatred for those people was able to bring a revival to those people. So, what is a weapon of our spiritual warfare? This thing right here. Let me ask you something. When Jesus walked the earth, how many people did he knock out? Help me. How many people did he just whack upside the head with a board? How many people did he gun down? How many people have we wanted to gun down? Careful. We got gun toters in here, right? Amen. Jesus never once raised a hand toward anybody except those people that had done what to the temple? Made a mockery of it. That was his anger. But never once did Jesus raise a hand toward anyone. Jesus spoke to them. The woman at the well, what did he speak to her? If you know who I am, somebody help me tonight. If you knew who I was, could you imagine what that woman was feeling in her soul when the God of all glory was saying, if you know who I am, you would be asking me for a drink of water? Somebody say amen. Could you imagine what was going through the soul of those disciples when they were walking along with Jesus and they didn't realize who it was? Something was burning down deep inside of their soul as Jesus spoke to them. Why? Because there was something powerful in the words that he spoke. Remember, the weapons of our warfare are what? They are not carnal, but they are mighty. And saints of God, the Spirit of God speaking through one of his children is more mighty than any sword out there. Somebody say amen. You get a Spirit-filled child of God speaking the Word of God with power and with anointing. Guess what? You can set all the enemies of this world to flight. Does anybody believe that tonight? You and I, with the words that God has given us, the anointing through the power of God, through his holy scriptures, you and I could speak a bond-breaking revival into Northern Kentucky. Does anybody believe that? Saints of God, there is power in what we do. God taught Joshua that in the words you speak, when they were all saying no, he was saying yes. And he wasn't just saying because of my knowledge. He was saying, God said, this is ours. This belongs to us. And how many of you will say to the things that are going on in your life today, God said. There is power in that, saints of God. God said. God said that when I speak to the enemy, he has to flee. Now that sounds good. When I speak to the enemy, he has to flee. When I use the word of God on my enemy, the Bible says it is like a two-edged sword. Somebody say amen. Cutting the enemy in two. Somebody say amen. And saints of God, that's what we need to be doing more and more of. Let me have you stand, please. Some folks need to go home and take a nap. Right, Jay? Saints, listen to me. What's the title of this message? Learning warfare from God. Some of the things that you and I go through, according to what we read in scriptures, God allows it to happen so that we could learn something. The next time you have the ability to speak something into someone and a negative thought or a negative word comes across your brain, what should you do? A instead of telling somebody I hate you, doesn't I hate you sound bad? JT, if somebody says it with a fervency, I hate you, that sounds horrible. But if you can say, I love you in the name of Jesus and mean it, doesn't that sound completely different? Church, I'm going through a big mess. Church, I'm going through a big problem. What should you say to me? Pastor, God is able. Amen. Sometimes when I don't know what to say to an individual, I'm going to say, I'm going to God for you. That's all I know to do. Saints, I'm going to tell you, there are times I don't have the answers, but you know what? Again, I know who does. And I'm more than willing to go to the one who does and say, God, I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't know what to say. But God, your word says that if I open my mouth and allow you to, you will fill it with the words that need to be spoken. How many of you believe that your warfare is going to begin right here? Both success and defeat. I am going to overcome. I am going to win this. I am going to, you name it. Northern Kentucky is going to be radically changed by the churches coming together and doing what they're supposed to be doing. You hearing me? You can believe it or disbelieve it, but you know what? I believe it. Because what I read in my word is when God's people become united, somebody say amen, great things begin to happen. When God's people come together and start thinking the same way, thinking that their God is all that and then some. Amen. Do you believe your God is all that and then some? You go around telling people, my God can heal cancer. My God can heal this. My God can do that. You know what you keep saying that, saints of God? It can happen. Sister Mary went on to be with the Lord, Mary Hill. Some people might say, Wayne, her words didn't win anything. Her words didn't mean anything. Baloney. She may not have been delivered from her cancer, but you know what? I guarantee you that woman is in heaven today dancing around saying, I got a better healing than I knew what I was asking for. Amen. One day when we get to the glory world, saints of God, and I can't wait to get there, we're going to get there and there's going to be words spoken. Not a negative word, but praises unto God. Somebody say amen. Praises that will last throughout eternity. Amen. Is your God able? A couple of you believe it. Is your God able? Have you bow your heads for a moment. If you're here tonight and you're not saved or you do not have a relationship with God, you don't even know what I'm talking about. I'm going to ask you to come and kneel down at an altar and let us come and talk with you and pray with you. You don't have a relationship with God, listen, let me introduce you to somebody, to a Savior that can change everything about you if you want Him to. Anybody like that tonight? Come on. I feel that God is dealing with a couple right now. Father, touch them right now, I pray, great and living God. Deal with their hearts, deal with their minds. God, we know that you've been speaking to them, Lord God. You've been dealing with them. You're tugging at their heart as we speak, God. Father, I pray right now that you would move upon them, God, and meet their needs. Jesus' holy name. Jesus' holy name. I hear Norman back there praying out loud. And they are positive words. They are words of power. Could I ask you to do me a favor, either in your seats or in these altars tonight? Can I hear you just start speaking power. Speak power over situations, over people, over regions, over areas. Speak it. Speak it with authority. Speak it with an anointing. Listen to me. Everyone in here, if you will allow God to anoint you, God will anoint you with the power, with an ability to speak with bold words that you never dreamed you could speak. Speak it now. Let's hear you. Let's hear you. Let me hear you lifting up your voices unto God. Let me hear you lifting up true praises unto God right now. Come on, saints of God, let's hear it. In Jesus' name.
Forever I am changed by your love.
Something. But can I tell you something? That's what makes it work, when you feel something. Amen. That lets me know that God's alive. Now be praying for Zach. Why should we pray for Zach, Pastor? Remember, there's power in your words. Amen. And when you're calling out Zach's name daily, multiple times a day, when the enemy starts to attack him, and how many of you know the enemy will attack him? If the enemy hears the prayers, if God hears the prayers of his children going up, guess what? Reinforcements are going to show up to where Zach is. Does anybody believe that? Amen.
We're talking about power of prayer and power of positive words. Is anybody here? This is Julia Mae Morgan, my grandbaby. She's nervous. She goes, I want to go to Nani. Thursday when we left church here, we went and prayed with the young man that he's dying. Well, while we're at the hospital, my daughter called and said that they were bringing this one to the hospital. She had ran into the coffee table and actually tore a tendon in her left arm. The doctor said it's extremely painful and it's going to take weeks for it to heal. We were praying at the church and we were praying at the hospital when we got there. And we actually had both grandbabies, and they thought that Violet was Julie. And she says, man, she's setting up. She's doing really good, but she wasn't. She was asleep. She was hurting real bad. So this went on for the weekend. We're supposed to see a specialist tomorrow, call a specialist for her arm. But God intervened in the power of prayer, and her arm is fine. She said her arm doesn't hurt anymore. And I'm not going to put her on the spot because we want her to sing pretty soon, so I'm not going to stress her out. But she knows whose Jesus house is. Amen. Don't you? This is, but it's all good. But what I'm saying to you is, even the baby, she's 2 years old, she knows what it means to pray, and she knows what it means to be in Jesus' house. You know, you can never start them too soon. May everyone stand.